Okay, so we have a powerful clip from your documentary that I want to show everybody. So let's take a look at that before we have a chat.
I remember the first time I saw a blue whale.
Oh, look, look.
Wow.
I followed them since childhood.
What do you think it's from? Is it from a ship?
I could see plastic everywhere. We were in what we thought was a relatively pristine environment. I started to wonder what was happening in oceans elsewhere on the planet. Growing up, my world was the ocean. It's where I feel the most spiritual.
As a freediver, it was the place where I proved myself to myself. Finally, I have the opportunity to pay the sea back.
Only a fraction of the plastic that we produce is recycled.
This is never going to degrade. It's got nowhere to go.
This was something that these animals, they were forced to endure because it was man-made and we'd put it into their environment.
The record is 276 pieces of plastic inside of one 90-day-old chick.
If the plastics are in the food chain for the dolphin, they're also in our food chain.
Exactly.
Communities are built on these landfill sites.
So sweet potatoes, corn, sugar cane. All growing on 40 years of garbage.
Do you have anything not wrapped in plastic?
No.
No.
We have to make our life better for our kids' children. Change is possible. It starts with us.
Wow. Wow. For any of you single people out there, this is not a date movie. It's very depressing. So that's footage, that early footage of that, of you looking out of that blue whale, that's from 2011.
That was 2012.
That, 2012.
That expedition, yes.
And at the point, you were off the coast of Sri Lanka, about 20 miles offshore. There hadn't been commercial fishing there in like years because of a civil war. And there is this emulsified mess of garbage.
Yeah, what we were trying to do was visit so-called pristine environments around the world to see how far plastics were spreading, because we knew that they were in the North Pacific Gyre. That was the impetus to start the film. And we knew that there are four other gyres. So if it's in the North Pacific, it must be in other gyres elsewhere around the planet. So we wanted to make our job difficult by going to the places where we thought there should be no plastic.
And I'm going to make your job difficult. Explain the word gyre to our audience.
Okay, so a gyre is one of, well, there are five ocean currents that drive everything we need on the planet to survive. They're moving big circular currents, and they do everything from generating weather patterns to moving temperatures to spreading fish and protein that we rely on. So they're critical, but what they also do is plastic enters the oceans from lakes and river systems and storm water drains and hits the ocean. It gradually moves to the center of these gyres, and it takes sometimes 30 to 40 years for that plastic to move there. And as it does get there, due to wave action and sunlight and oxygen, the plastic breaks up. And we say breaking up because plastic doesn't biodegrade. If we say something breaks down, people tend to think it goes away, but it doesn't. It just gets smaller and smaller, and by the time it reaches the center of these gyres, it's almost invisible. It's so tiny.
So when people talk about that Great Pacific Garbage Patch, it's not really an island. It's these sort
of... You can't see it. It's not an island as big as Texas, as we've been told. It's actually the water appears gin clear,
right.
And it's not until you drag what we call manta trawls through it that we start to see what's even more insidious, and that's these microplastics. And what we found in the first expedition we did there was 46,000 pieces of plastic for every square mile.
46,000 pieces of plastic
yes.
for every square mile.
And I've since found more than that in other jars around the world.
So just to put some numbers on here, and I've got some notes here to help me, but we have the world's plastic producers produce 300 million tons each year, and half of that is only used once. 8 million tons of that leaks into the oceans each year, and half of that sinks to the bottom. But as you say, it's indestructible. It breaks up, but it breaks apart, but it doesn't break down. And so all those tiny pieces of microplastic are just sitting there.
Yeah, and it's an amazing concept, and we fell for it. I fell for it. Plastics were invisible to me before I started this project, before the idea was brought to me by the producer of the film. You know, I'm an oceans guy. I'm a surfer. I'm a documentarian of oceans, and I dive, and yet I had no idea that this product was causing this problem. And the reason was because it became invisible to all of us, because we use it. It's such a powerful, such a useful product. So what we were finding was that, as you said, you know, up to 70% of plastics actually sink. So what we're finding in the oceans at the surface is just the tip of the iceberg of the problem.
Yeah. And this is where it gets into the food chain, because as we saw, there were seabirds eating that. You found 276 pieces of plastic in that 90-year-old chick.
Yeah.
I mean, in the movie, which is not a date movie, again, when you cut open the stomachs of these birds, you see these hard pieces of plastic.
Yes, yeah. This was when I actually felt personally culpable, where I felt responsible as an individual, was when we went to Lord Howe Island, and we would walk along during the fledging season on the beach with Jen Labers, the scientist, and we would find dozens of dead baby birds on the beach.
Right.
And when you cut them open, their stomachs are literally bursting with plastics.
Mm-hmm.
And in there, you see everyday objects that you use, even golf tees, toys, bits of plastic, balloon ties are very prevalent, and bottle caps. Mm-hmm. And when I first saw that red bottle cap, mm-hmm. I realized that that could have been a bottle cap from a drink beverage that I threw away 10 years beforehand, and didn't realize the consequences of my action. So I could have personally been responsible for that bird's death, and a very painful death, and if not that bird, then maybe a bird somewhere else on the world's oceans.
So, and this has been measured in a lot of different ways, but 5 trillion pieces of plastic afloat, microplastic, afloat in our oceans right now.
A very conservative estimate.
5 trillion pieces,
yeah. And if you measure that, I mean, you think about that. When the scientists first told me that, I thought, that's just too big of a volume to comprehend for someone who's a director, a visual guy. So I went back to them and said, can you put that into a visual for me?
Right.
And they said, well, okay, if you were to stack all of that plastic into one place, it would fill the 8th largest country on the planet. Right. Any guesses as to what country that is? Anyone know the geography? Argentina. A big country, and it would not only cover the entire country, but it would cover that country up to 30 centimeters above the ground.
Oh, God. You have this remarkable ability as a filmmaker to personalize this, and to, as you said, to make everyone feel it. I watched the movie twice, first time with my wife, and we were very depressed, and we were feeling sorry for phytoplankton, which is hard to do. It's hard to get somebody to feel sorry for phytoplankton, but as you look through this, you see in some parts of the ocean, there's as much plastic, microplastic, as phytoplankton.
Yeah. Yeah, look, it's the way I wanted to engage an audience to create awareness, because our film was the first to do that, to create awareness. Up until that point, there was very little concern about single-use plastics. And in fact, there's even very little data or research. We had to go and do that ourselves, which is why we took scientists on every trip. So I wanted to take people on the journey, and it was important to do that within the way I shot the film, so that everybody could come along and feel and see and empathize with what I was feeling, what Tanya Streeter, the freediver, was feeling, what our scientists were feeling and seeing. And when you're presented with things like seabirds, yeah, you kind of get that. But then when you go even further down the food chain to the very base and you see plankton
Right.
And we were the first to release footage of plankton consuming microplastics. Then you realize we've got a major problem.
And then the zooplankton are feeding on the phytoplankton, and the small fish and the shrimp, which you show, are feeding on that. And then the squid and the mussels and the tuna are feeding on that. And then the whales, of course, are taking it all in. But the key part here that brings this home is we're consuming this.
Yes. So what's happening is this is all bioaccumulating up the food chain.
Right.
So as plankton eat a small piece of plastic, then a tiny fish eats the plankton, a bigger fish eats that, squid eats that, a tuna comes along, eats the squid, shark eats that.
Right.
It goes up and up the food chain, and it's not the plastic that's the particular problem. What's the major problem are the toxins that attach to plastic. So plastics have these large molecules, and when they enter the ocean, there are other toxins in the ocean. These are runoffs from agriculture, from mining, even from your car tires, which are comprised mainly nylon. These wash off into the ocean. We get cadmium and mercury and zinc and all these problem heavy metals. And they don't like water, so they attach to something that they do like, and that is plastic. Mm-hmm. So when fish consume these plastics, what happens then is that these heavy metals and toxins go, there's something even better to attach to, and that is tissue. They prefer oils and fatty tissue. So they release from the plastic, they attach to the heavy, the oils and the fatty tissue of the fish, and they bioaccumulate in that fish. So when something else eats that fish that has consumed that fish consumes all of the toxins that were present on the plastic.
It's a horror film.
And then, who's at the top of the food chain?
That's right. And so you mentioned that 2.6 billion people in the world have the oceans as their primary source of protein. So they're feeding off of this as well, or we're feeding off of this, I say. It's the world's largest source of protein, this ocean. And so you have this very compelling conversation with a scientist who ran the World Health Organization's report on endocrine disruption. Talk a little bit about that and why this is so key to this.
Yeah, so when you suddenly realize that we're at the top of the food chain, then you start to look at the human health component. And that's where A Plastic Ocean went from being an oceans-based documentary, which is how it started, to actually being a human health documentary.
Right.
Everywhere we went, we got more questions, not answers. So we increased the scope, and that's why the film took 8 years to make. And what we realized was that we're ultimately the filters. And so we took this problem to scientists and said, look, do we really know what problems that's causing us? And so we started to look at that. Now, scientists at Brunel University started to look at that. And we started to look at other effects. It's not just consuming fish and marine organisms. It's if you eat cheese wrapped in plastic, if you drink beverages out of plastic bottles, what does that do? What kind of transference of those chemicals happen? And what we found is that most of them actually leach, and they leach very easily. And so what we found and our scientists found was that a lot of these chemicals have, like phthalates and bisphenol A's, which are very prevalent, the major chemicals in a lot of these products and in the food we eat from the ocean, contain estrogenic activity.
They mimic the hormones. They mimic the human hormones.
Exactly. So our bodies our endocrine system produce hormones in very, very small amounts that regulate everything, that build us from children, who we become, who we are, what we look like. And these estrogenic activity, the estrogenic activity in these chemicals, not only mimic sometimes, but they block.
They latch onto the receptors where the normal hormone should go, and they block you from getting the needed.
That's right. And so what we found out for the first time was that these are causing diabetes, certain cancers, reproductive problems, cognitive disabilities in children.
Early development is key. That's what's so key. Yeah. So we're really thinking about an entire next generation of people. There's the plastic problem. As much as virtually every piece of plastic that's ever been made is still here, as Tony Fadell said yesterday, but this is becoming even more of a problem as we consume more and more of this plastic and it accumulates.
Yeah, so we go back to this issue of how we were all kind of conned about using this product. How can a product that's designed to be the most durable product ever created, how can that be disposable?
Right.
And as William said earlier, this notion of away is just absolutely a con.
Yeah.
There is no away. It may move away from you as you put it into your bin, and that gets taken away, but it does come back to you.
So that is the message, and you do actually devote a fair amount of the film to where we go from here, how we solve this problem. And we've heard some of that. We've heard some great ideas about how to create incentives through capital structures, but it's ultimately us, the customers, that make the difference.
Yeah, when we actually finished editing the film and we had a rough cut, we sat there and we watched it, and at the end of it, we were like, I mean, we'd been doing this for 8 years and we were still dumbstruck by how depressing this film was.
Yes.
And I realized that we couldn't have people, the audience, leaving the cinemas going, there's no hope, there's nothing we can do, because there always is hope. I mean,
the message? Not a date movie. Right?
Not a date
not
movie.
Date,
I mean,
right.
You know, the Minister for the Environment in Chile, when I met him, said to me, he said, my wife made me watch this film, and he said, we both cried, and she woke up the next morning and dug me in the ribs and said, you're the Environment Minister for Chile, go in and do something.
About it, yeah.
And eventually they banned plastic bags across the entire country. But, you know, back to that point, we were so depressed that we went back and we spent 6 months filming the third act of the film, refilming it to include solutions. And I think that actually becomes a very powerful part of the film, where people leave having seen the film, knowing that as an individual, there is actually something they can do. And they're a very important part of the solutions.
I love the way William McDonough just framed this. He said, there's insight, there's overview, and then protocols, So what specifically can we do? What's the takeaway for the very powerful people in this room?
Okay, the first thing we have to do is ban single-use plastics. These are toxic substances. If it existed in any other form, we wouldn't be allowed to sell them, use them, or consume them. So we've absolutely got to ban them. And we've got to declare them toxic, because if we declare them toxic, then they will fit into regulations that already exist that deal with toxic substances. So that's a very easy thing. I'm very much...
And you have actually a good example of this with Germany. So you actually say regulation works here.
So regulation, I push regulation because I see where that works. Humans, we're like water. We follow the path of least resistance, and corporations are the same. If you're unregulated, you'll do whatever you can to produce your product and return value to shareholders rather than care about the environment or the health of the customer. So you have to regulate, and Germany did that in 1991 and forced manufacturers to be responsible for their product, cradle to cradle. And what that did was that created the first circular economy, which was managed by DSD, a quasi-government institution that was funded by levies on plastic products. And they formed the Green Dot System, and it worked. They started dealing with 90% of their waste instead of 7%. And unfortunately, no one else picked up on that, and still many countries haven't. So legislation is key. Education is vital. I talk at schools all around the world, and the one thing...
Before you get there, I want to stick with the regulation, because we've got a lot of business people here, people represent corporations, and I thought that, again, to come back to what William McDonough said, the circular economy has actually been good for companies, because fundamentally it's what their customers want.
Yeah, I don't believe that the circular economy is the answer. I think it is a transition period. What we need is a loop system, like TerraCycle are looking at. We need to stop using and convincing ourselves that we can recycle these products when we can't. As I mentioned to you earlier, recycling isn't broken. It just never worked, and it was never designed to work. It was a con perpetuated by manufacturers of plastics who wanted to put the blame on consumers, which allowed them to continue to produce this product. So if you don't admit that you're responsible for your product, you say, well, look, the consumer wants it, so we're just giving them what they want, and then say it's up to the consumer to be responsible for this product, then you can keep manufacturing that product. We can't do that anymore. We've despoiled the environment to a state now where the life support systems are not working anymore.
So let's get a consumer or a corporate or a business person to have a question here. Anybody? Can we get it? Can we get our Wranglers, somebody in there? I know Tony is desperate to say something. He's laughing, he's cheering, come on. Okay, somebody else, we have somebody who wants to say something? Right there, we've got, okay. Can you just please identify yourself?
I'm Priscilla Liu, I head up sustainable investment for DWS, which I shall try to rename circular investment from now on. So I have a question. I mean, quite some many, many decades ago, people have this notion of depositing, bottle deposits or aluminum can deposits, and then you're motivated to then send it back to wherever the recycling that could actually classify or mechanically sort accordingly. And that's gone away. One of the big challenges is this mechanical sorting so that you can actually more properly take care of how to dispose it or get rid of it. And I was just wondering, in your solution for how to address this, is there any way that could actually drive corporations to really put the onus on themselves to try and become a part of the, you know, cradle to cradle and actually, and it does cost, really impose the cost rather than the convenience. One of the things when I looked into plastic straws versus paper straws, it turns out that plastic straws were way cheaper than paper straws. Yep. And so people are motivated by profit.
Absolutely.
Would not do that. And so the question is, if there is an cost to disposing plastic and you have to charge that up front, then perhaps then the folks would be incented to move it in the right direction.
Yeah. There are two things here. Firstly, the cost price is exactly a problem. And that's why if you're someone like McDonald's and you sell 500 million straws a day, then 0.01% of a cost difference is an enormous amount. So what I say when I talk to corporations all over the world about this is stop looking at the upfront cost. Start building costs into the back end, into your marketing. Start developing the message to your future consumers and customers that you're providing sustainability within your product and you're considering the environment within your economic calculations, and you will start to get in front of the curve when the new set of consumers, i.e. the kids of today, who don't want to be involved in despoiling the environment, come online, because they will invest in your product. They will be your consumer if you deal with that properly. Going back to your first point, the circular economy, in my opinion, is a transition to what you describe, what we used to have, the loop cycle. And this is where the TerraCycle is promoting this. Going back to the old milk bottle syndrome, where we were provided with a product in a container or packaging that was collected, washed, refilled, and sent back to us. And this is coming back, and this is a future product. It's already being trialed in the US, in Europe, and it's very successful. It makes people, it's more expensive, but the customer feels like they're doing good. Once again, the back end is working because they will pay more if they feel as though they're actually contributing to the environment, to the society, and the future of their children. So I think we will see more of that happening. Going back to what Tony was saying yesterday, it's improving products, discovering new polymers that we can use, and we need to support young entrepreneurs who are the future in the work that they do to do this. And we're already seeing these guys are hungry. We need to let them understand that they can monetize this, that they can get rich. It's not a bad thing to do that if you're helping the environment and securing the future so that everybody continue to prosper. And as William said, we've got this growth rather than this problem that we see that's very dull and boring to deal with and ultimately expensive because it's at the expense of our personal well-being.
I see William McDonough's over there. Unfortunately, we are out of time, so you're going to have this question at lunch. But the most important thing in about your bio is that you're a fourth-generation journalist. I think that comes through loud and clear with this absolutely terrific reporting and filmmaking.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Craig Leeson.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Thank you.